I've got a few questions for you. One, why is it so hard for music producers to finish their tracks, no matter whether you're a seasoned pro or just starting out? Question two, why is it beneficial to work dawlessly in order to create and make tracks faster? Three, why is it beneficial to create a network of peers of like-minded people around you? All these questions will be addressed in this video. Knowing when to stop producing and having fun. When is your track done? That's today's video. Are you ready for it? Let's go and do it right now. Hey, what's up? I'm in the kitchen and thank you for checking out yet another video. Now, if this is your first time here, don't hesitate to click subscribe and hit that notification bell. Whenever I upload a new video, you'll be kept in the loop and you'll not miss out on anything. Stick around to the end of this video. I will tell you all about the dance carousel. And I will tell you all about the stuff that we're doing. It's very exciting times. Stay tuned. There are several reasons why both new up-and-comers and already established music producers are struggling to finish their music tracks. One is the loop trap. Electronic music production often starts with creating catchy loops or riffs. However, expanding those loops into a full, well-structured song can be a challenge. There's choice overload. Modern DAWs, digital audio workstations, offer a vast array of sounds, plugins, and effects. This abundance of options mostly leads to so many indecisions and analysis paralysis that it's hard to figure out what is what. Then, of course, there's perfectionism. I struggle with that as well. The desire to create a perfect, polished song can be a major roadblock. Then there, of course, is the fear of failure. And releasing music can be nerve-wracking. The fear of negative feedback or rejection is something most people are not really looking forward to. And it can prevent producers from finalizing their work. These challenges, like I said, apply to both new upcomers and established musicians. New artists might lack experience and the experience to mix and master their tracks, so they're afraid that their sound is not going to sound the way it's supposed to sound. And whilst experienced artists might have developed a more critical ear, they will overdo it and be too critical. With too much knowledge comes very many options, and many options still do the same thing as with new artists. You just don't know. So, are there any tips to help you out? Glad you asked. This is what I would do. This is what I should have done ages ago, and that's what I'm doing now. So, set a deadline. Make sure that you give yourself an X amount of time within brackets and within you force yourself to finish a project. Make decisions and focus on those decisions and stick by them. Work in stages. Focus on completing specific aspects of the track like drums, bassline, melody, etc. Embrace imperfections. Not everything needs to be pointed and stuck on the wall of the museum. Make sure that when you make a mistake, learn from the mistake, and sometimes mistakes can invoke happy accidents. It's something you want and need. Get feedback, but we'll get into that. Take a break. Don't focus and overfocus and overproduce. At some point, if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. I always say, within 5 hours, I'd like to get something on tape or at least something substantial that I would love to finish that I can come back to and think like, okay, this is something that I need to develop further. Is there an advantage of working dawlessly? I think yes. There can be advantages to create tracks and finish them faster while you work dawlessly, but it all depends on your organizational skill, the gear you're using, and the way your setup is. You know, your workflow is also very important. Advantages, I would say, are the simpler workflow. When you work in the DAW, there are so many options, and I think you can limit those options when you work with a live set. Think of the band members, give your band members a task. If you've got a bass synthesizer, stick with the bass synthesizer. Don't have it play leads. If you've got drums or a machine that does drums, but it can also do synths, have it play drums and just stick with that. You can always expand when you get further on and more experienced, but if you just want to set out to finish a track, do not give yourself too many options. Too many options will just make insecurity, and insecurity is not the best partner in order to finish convincing tracks. Distraction reduction is another one. If you can focus on a few things, you will not get distracted and you'll just focus on trying to just focus on what needs to be done. You know, what is it that I want from the track? Also ask yourself, what kind of a performer am I? What kind of an artist am I? Now, the music industry offers you three options when you start out. I mean, this is what it is. If you want to learn music, I think you can narrow it down to three options. You either are a performing artist, which means you're up on stage, performing, learning a skill and performing it to people, or you are the studio producer. You're in the studio, you're trying to nerd around with the gear that you have, or you're the sound engineer, so you perfect the sound that's already there. Those are the three options. When you work Dwalessly, you obviously have to now combine all these three things together, because there's a bit of sound design, there's a bit of arranging your track, there's a bit of performing there as well. But narrow it down to a few options, to a few things that you can manage, that you can convincingly do, that you know, build up muscle memory. And when that's happening, you'll see, hey, you'll learn. So from the minute you know the muscle memory, that's only there to progress to the next stage, meaning there's more that you will experience. And you have to also give yourself some room to know something that you can perfect. And that's not something you do consciously, it does happen. You know, sometimes I think that I know everything because I've been in this game like forever, and then boom, there's something that I just didn't think of, like, whoa, how did that happen? You know, that's the beauty of it. Dwaless setups always limit editing and arrangement capabilities. It's basically on off, you know, the beats in there or the beats out of there. And there's not a lot of guns in their own, white noise, whooshes and whatever, you know. There's a few things that really, really work. And in the beginning, this is also a pitfall. You think, why is the track not finished? Because it doesn't really, is dressed up the way it's dressed up. And I know within my education, that the stuff that I teach people, I tell them about the ABC priority, about like A is the foundation of the house, B are the walls and the doors and the windows, and C is like whatever's in the house, the interior, in order to build up your track and make it a sustainable track that works, that sounds great. But when you get to a Dwaless live set, all of a sudden, the white noise, in order to just like make a drop, and the transition into a drop or out of a drop, whoa, that also some becomes a cumbersome task if you only got two hands. So if you limit your editing and your other skill sets, or you give different things tasks to do, you'll see that it's easy and you'll wrap your head around the vast information flow that's already there, and just narrow it down to a few chunks that are easy to manage. Of course, there is a learning curve when you work Dwalessly. That is a thing. So you cannot just like buy equipment and think like this is it, right? But the first thing is to learn the equipment. When you learn the equipment, you also develop your hearing, you develop your production skills. So there is a lot of work that you would normally just like do by looking at tutorials, much like this one, that you can already do while learning your sampler, learning your gear. And by the time you learn it, you already know something, and then I think you're a few steps ahead. Also, the genre of music is very important, so pick something that suits you well. Don't experiment with different tasks, you know, I mean, drum and bass, trap, house, techno, progressive house, hardcore, whatever, you know, down tempo, lo-fi. They're all different styles that require a different approach, which means that if a bass drum is mixed in X genre, it will be something else in another genre. So stick with something you would like to know and perfect it to the point where you think, I can't perfect it anymore. Then run with it, and then from the minute you feel confident and comfortable enough to really play it to people, play it to peers, and get some constructive criticism and feedback, and work it from there. Now, why is it beneficial to also, I already tapped on that a little bit a while ago, why is it also important to create a network of peers around you? Well, for one, you can share your music. For two, you can remix other people's music. Three, you're not alone. You know, you can ask people like, what's happening? I would suggest though, that if you ask 100 people or you ask one person, it's pretty much the same thing. 100 opinions, a bit hard to work. One opinion, is that the direction that I'm thinking of? So create a network of people around you that you trust and that are on your level as well. It was cool to just go up to the biggest DJ in the world, biggest artist, and ask them like, can you listen to my track? Probably not the best idea, because they will now give you advice that might not really coincide with where you are. So find people on your level and feed off them. You know, don't see it as competition. See it as a self-development, and that's really cool. Try and get up on stage as fast as you can. Find open spots, open places where there's a low level, there's not a lot of pressure on you to perform like I did wrong in the beginning. I couldn't help it. I mean, I scored world hit records, which kicked me on stages in front of 10,000 people with zero experience. Not the best experience in the world. It's nerve-wracking, but if that's the case, then that's the case, you'll probably deal with it. But if you can, just like ease yourself into this industry, ease yourself into the workflow, ease yourself into everything, and then that's a cool thing. Online communities, there's a lot of online communities that work, which brings me to my patreon.com/analogkitchen, by the way, which is one of those communities where you can actually find like-minded peers, where you can find people that can help you out, that are there to help you, that will listen to your tracks, that will tell you how you can package your stuff, travel with it, that can do challenges, and that challenges the dance carousel, more on that later. But those are things to actually just better yourself and get advice and tips. And I do think that I can say that I've seen my community grow, that I see producers that have been with me ever since I had like 200 and 300 subscribers that are now still here and that are actually performing artists now, that can say, I know how to make a live set, I know how to transition. It helps to be a part of a community, and that's cool. And if you live somewhere where you can actually find people that perform or at least have these synth meetups or whatever, try and just connect with them. You'll enjoy yourself. What if you can't find the time or the inspiration to find something that you would like to perfect and finish even? You know, then it might be cool to think of, are there any tracks that my peers have made that are also not finished that I can just like feed off of? So there's a theme that I think, wow, it's really inspiring. Do you mind if I can work around with it? See if you can download remix contests online. There are a lot of vocals, if you like to work with vocals, well recorded and mixed vocals, so you don't have to really strain yourself in buying microphones and buying preamps and getting that stuff going. Something that you can ease yourself into again, you know? Try that out. There's something else that also helps finishing tracks. Remixes come with deadlines. Deadlines need to be met. So obviously, if you say yes to a remix, it means that you have to finish it within a certain time. You have to kill your baby sometimes. It's not something that people like to hear or like to do, but it is something that has to be done. You know, at some point you need to just like give it to the universe and let other people decide. Things to consider when you do remixes. Obviously, choose a project that you like and that you value. That's something that you can learn from, but that you like to do. Otherwise, it becomes a chore. And tasks and chores are not the greatest things that you would like within the music industry. You would love to just like have fun, right? Also, respect the original artist's vision when you're doing a remix, because it forces you out of your comfort zone and then you'll learn something. Because a reason for people not to finish their tracks is sometimes that they stick within their own little hamster wheel, which is cool, but it also puts the blinds on. And sometimes you just need to step out of your comfort zone, try something else. So as much as it is cool to find a remix assignment you like, it can also be very, very, enlightening to try something different. Combine all the approaches that I just told you, and I think you've got ample ideas of what you can do. I think that now it's time that I would show you how I finish my tracks, or at least how I can come to terms with what I think is, this is a finished track. So I will show you a track that I've been working on, that I have performed with already. I'll show you what the ingredients are and why I decided to use those ingredients. And no, I saw some comments, people thinking, yeah, you're just showing off, you're just doing this, you're just doing that. I am here to really tell people how it works for me. And I know that when it works for me, it will work for you as well, because it's just something that's been proven out there. I'm not here to just like show you how well I can use my equipment, because as a matter of fact, I really don't really know my equipment that well that I think that I'm the top of everything. But it's something I just wanted to address. So follow along, follow these steps. You don't have to have the same equipment as I have, just within the boundaries of how I approach my stuff. Let's go. Are you still talking? Yes. Okay, let's go to the lifestyle and let's go make it work. You ready? Let's go. Now, there's a few things that we need to establish before we start first, right? So we're talking about loop-based music here. So we are going to do everything within the boundaries of a loop. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And so on and so forth. Now, the setup is simple. I've got a 303. This acts as a catalyst. The reason I do this is because this and this is instantly going, right? I can open this up. But in order for me to just like have a completely finished tracks, I will work my way up in steps. This works. This works. So it means that all the drums work together with a 303. This can be house in itself, right? Baseline. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. So what we got now is this. I will always start with the 303. Love the 303. Amazing machine. Love it. So I can tune it high. I can tune it to the middle. And I can tune it low. In order for it to really be a catalyst within the music. There's effects on this as well. So the TB-03, look it up. It's an amazing machine. I'm not going to get into what all the machines are doing. I'm only going to tell you what I'm using. You'll figure it out for yourself as you have to decide which one of the machines is yours anyway. Now, I've got a subsequent 37, which is the biggest bad boy. I've got an SH-101 that I will connect for next week's video, probably. Yeah? Okay, so that's that. And then I've got... with a self-made sound on there. Connected to this big space here. This is the Amplitude by IK Multimedia. This is their brand. So I've got the desk here. There's a 008, RK008, which is the brain of the operation. It means now it stops. Now it plays. I can do it from the 7, from the 6. Now it stops. Now it starts. And everything is daisy chained. So let's first talk about what we have right here. Let's first talk about what we have right here. There's a lot of equipment, but still it's very manageable. There's stuff that remembers what's being programmed. There's stuff that gets a pulse that plays by themselves. There's stuff that records MIDI notes, and then there's stuff that does filtering. So here is my drum computer, the Octatrack. Here is one of the baseline computers called the TB-03. I'm not going to get into the specifics of what it does, but take my word for it, absolutely amazing machine. So when I've got a kick drum here, and I've got the TB-03 here, this is my second track, Bank 2. You can see that the two now, this red lit, illuminated red, which means Bank 1-1, it's going to be the first bank. I opted to go for the second track, so here, track 2, Bank 2, means this blinking light on 2 is also the second sequence on the TB-03 that corresponds to this, whatever happens here. As is what this thing does, is my 10-10 black box. The 10-10 black box got like vertical rows also, but I've opted to go for vertical rows. So the first row is track 1, track 2, track 3, track 4. And then if I go to my preset set, you can see I've got like different ones here, here and here, which means a 4, 8, and then 12, and then 16 tracks in total. 16 banks in total, 2 times 8, 16 in total. So everything corresponds. Now, this thing is taking care of the MIDI. So it does that from here. This is the 006. I can program these outputs to be MIDI, to be DIN sync, to be triggers, so I can do whatever I want. And this corresponds with this little calculator machine right here called the RK008 by RetroKids. So this is the brain of the operation. I love it. This is CIA work. The smallest machine to take care of everything. You don't believe me? There you go. So, and I can even do it from the side here. Woo! So this one controls this one, this one controls this one, this one controls this one, and this one controls this one. So you can see all the lights. If I'm stopping it here, everything stops. In the top corner here, it says 6 divided by 4, which is like 6th bar out of 1, 2, 3, 4. I will start and everything starts. So this light will go on, this light will go on to play. So if you look at this, bam, on, this runs. And this runs, boom, doo, doo, doo. So cool. That's my first intro to this first song. So this is already something like, okay, I can check the box, this works. Now, moving on to the next segment is, this is a effect that runs through the normal output of the black box. This is a filter that runs through the second output of the 10-10 black box. So there's two different outputs that I'm using, and I'm using it because if I'm building up the track, I'm trying to find stuff that goes in my ABC category. So I first want to get something that will go, that I will engage, and it will help my track forward. Let me turn it down a little bit. It was a bit on the loud side. So, arpeggio here, and you very resilient, keen, focused people hear that this is half tempo of this. So this goes to double tempo. 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4. So I love that. In order for me to start up a track and for you to start dancing, I figured out that if I've got like half tempo arpeggio on one machine and a double tempo on the other machine, it just works. Listen to this. So that's working, right? Cool. Now, this TB-03, I have to tell you now, can do one of three things. It can be the bass line. This is very bright, so I have to just figure out with the filters here, can I steer the filters towards what you have here to do? Something like this. Or I can have this be a little bit more of a solo instrument, which is an octave up. Taking out of bass territory because got my bass right here, right? Let's turn up this kick drum a little bit because or turn down the stereo output. So the routing is not a video. I'm not going to get into the routing too much. Only that I've got my kick drum separately coming out. As you can see, the light blinking, which means I'm already kicking its butt. So let's turn it down a little bit. Nope, that's not. I like my kick to be loud. Okay, cool. So now we've got this. Of course, there's more drums. So let's turn this off, and let's get this out of the way. You see 303 here, means no 303. So this is my kick. Rest of my drums, a hat. That's supposed to be a hat. That is very, very, very short. I can tell you that now. Yeah, so then there's, oh, there you go. Yeah, give it a little bit more release. Also on a 16th, if I'm going to record it on one bar, it can do four bars, obviously, but it's only one bar, so it goes to one, right? So with the kick, bam, two, boom, three, four, and one. So there you go. And then it says nothing, but if I go in, you can see it is engaged. This is a snare roll. It only works if I'm opening this up. So it means that I can now introduce a little bit of a adrenaline kind of vibe. Track four is an open head, again with no release, and it is a, yeah, what is it? Thinking a 909 or a 707 hat. Let's check out what it is. TR-707 hat, I knew it. So, which sounds like a 909 hat, but it's not. It's a little bit dirtier, it's a little bit more gritty, so I mean, like, I'm liking using that. See? Bum dip, bum dip, bum dip, bum. Cool, we're going. Okay, track five. There's a loop here, which does. Yeah, boop, boop. The delay on there, sounds like it. Yeah, why is that? Okay. Yeah, maybe a little bit. So I'm trying to dress it up already here, right? So, because I know that this is already working, right? Track six is percussion. Because I'm trying to just like make this already very current, very now. If I'm just using a drum computer, it's going to sound like a drum computer, and I want it to sound like a little bit more like a record, right? So I can flirt with things. So loop here, loop here. I can choose to just have like single drums here. I can choose to have multiple drums like with this. So this is more of a hip shaking, booty shaking kind of vibe. Together with a dirty, like 8-bit hat, something like that. And then the rest of my drums are 2, 3, and. Track seven is always going to be my bass line, yeah? So, this sounds like function and engaging means everything will play like so, 2, and. So it's a cool thing that I can, with one hand, can program this now. Bass line in, kick out, like so. And then, as you can hear, up, get the kick in. Now, I don't want to hold the kick out constantly, so what I'm doing is that from the minute I am actually opening this up and the roll is there, you can hear the kick goes away. So now within this one bar sequence that we have, there's a lot possible, you know, there's a lot of possibilities. So with the 303, a little bit of delay on there, a little bit of cut off. We're going to go in with everything like one, two, one, two, three, and. So that's already working. Now, this is my foundation. If you cannot dance to this, I do not know what on earth is happening, right? So, let's go in here and let's turn this off. And let's go in here. Cool. So it means now that I've got this going, right? Let's turn this off. This catalyst will run all the time, no matter if I'm going to do chord changes, which I'm going to do in a second. This will always stay on. That's the root note, like bum 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 bum. You can hear it here. Well, this, because it's playing all the notes of the music that I'm going to introduce in a second, this already works for me, right? Okay, now the other one. Bum, 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 bum. Now you can hear. And if you pay attention, you can hear that this and this conga those do the same thing. It's off, listen here. So the notes that are playing here almost play the same thing. Right? This loop is mainly there to just dirt. I just want to add dirt to it, you know, to just like dirtify everything up. So cool, beats. Okay. Now, in order to think like, when is my track finished? I literally just thought of like, okay, kick, right? Kick, dun, 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 baseline here. But this baseline and this baseline, they work together. Cool. So this is just the foundation, right? Okay, then the rest of the drums go in. This is helping the groove, propel the groove forward. So the open head that we had right here does the same thing as jab, 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 jab. See? So everything fits together. So I'm just layering stuff as it was. Okay, now that we have that, let's introduce this thing that we have here. Taking out a little bit of the delay, because if I want to have a little bit more of a groove of a drive going, which means that more delay makes it very spacious, very sci-fi, and that's not what I want right now. I want you to forget about this thing, but only miss it when it's off, right? So let's overdo it a little bit so you can constantly find it, which means I'm going to open up the frequency filter, give you more of the high frequency, you can follow it better, right? Turn it down a little bit here. Cool. Okay. Now there's another baseline that I have programmed on the second pattern. It basically means that if I'm going to the bass here, 7, and play there, boom, boom, you can see here, and here comes, one, and again I engage it here, and then I engage it here, and I engage it here, boom, boom. So literally, it's a sample that plays a longer sequence. Look at this. As you can hear. So if I'm taking everything out except one. There you go. The first one. Three. Let's take everything out. Now you can hear that it plays a melody. But I don't want to give that away on my first sequence. So what I've done is one sample that I just shortened. So again, boom, starts again. And then here, boom, again, boom. And again, boom, this is pattern 3. And then here, boom. So now, this does what it does. It's like a little bit of variation. So I've created this longer bass line, and then I'm going to reveal on the second pattern. So listen to this. This one goes down a little bit. Pattern two, here we go. Pattern two. One, two, one. Oh, it's going to take a while. Okay, it's the last installment because I've got half tempo at one. Now we can get this different bass line. Play this. Pop. Ooh. And then we go up. And then we go up, and up, and up, and up. And then I've created a line that I think this should be the whole track. When I've got this, I don't have to do anything else. So if I was to do a solo, forgive me, I'm going to hit wrong notes. I'll probably play something that can go over the top. So I'm just thinking harmonies, right? So I'll play something like this. So that's something that I think can fit over this bass line. Obviously, it would work better if I'm using rave sounds for it. So I've created rave sounds already on the Temtem Black Box that are going to do that exact same thing, but now with chords. And it plays then. With the beats. And I can filter it out. So that's cool. So now I've got a track and then I can play my solo here. Woo. You know, I'll play it live and then there's an extra thing that I can do now. This means that I've got four segments that I can do. I can play this. Turn this off. Turn this down. So it's there, but you don't hear it. So you can only hear the pop. So now I've got my drums. Boom. This is the track. And then bass line plays an intricate part here. Right? So everything's on the same root note. So I'll start with the. Which is nice. So I'm thinking of a theme that goes. Quite simple, right? So loop based. Hypnotize you. You know, you're standing there and think, yeah, that's cool. With the bass line. Let's go back to pattern one. One, two, switch back to. Cool. So now I think that will literally just conclude the track because I can stretch it out and play it. Now, the trick with trying to figure out how these things work is, like I said in the intro, not give yourself too many options. You should not give yourself too many options. This is how it should work. Now, if I'm going to build up the track, I'm going to just like do a small jam and see how I'm going to build it up, right? So everything goes off, one, two, three, and then it's like. Thank you. And that's how I would work it. Very simple. Now, I can do more, I can add more stuff, but it's basically one theme that I think I can introduce as the biggest theme that I can open up with a filter. One arpeggio that plays, but that's also on the same filter. So taking the bass line out and the kick you'll hear, there's another drop. So I think that whenever I take out the drums, it should really work as a bigger sort of like drop. This can be a drop, which is a smoother drop, listen. And then you see that I came from all the way down on the tuning, three octaves down, back to the middle octave, back to the top octave. So if I was to just like now think, let's wind down this track, let's go back to the 303 bass line, we'll go in like. And I also use the overdrive here. Take out delay. And then full circle. Drum roll. Go into the other vibe. And if I want to just tone it down, I'm not going to introduce that bass line again, because the bass line tells you, okay, let's go. And then you can transition into a different track. But that's a different video. I also got some great news, because all these tips that I have has been my research, and I'm going to start working on an Analog Kitchen Dwaless Bible, which means that everything you heard me say is actually in a PDF format. So I'm going to stick that up on my patreon.com/analogkitchen once I've got more information. So the topics that I'm talking about and the research that I've done, I've just categorized it, and it looks absolutely awesome. I swear it's really, really great, because I did a lot of stuff just flying by the seat of my pants. That's just how this industry really got me going. Made a record got successful, awesome. I have to now make do with what's happening. Then you start to develop yourself and think of stuff. And now I've got more of a philosophy on where I think things need to go. And I am figuring it out. Also, there's so many different tools nowadays as well. There's AI, so I can get to the ideas a lot faster. So that's going to be put up within the next few weeks. Okay, so I'd like to say welcome to Duke Delat. He's a patron for this month, I think, this week even. And thank you for supporting the vibe. He's following everything on said patreon.com/analogkitchen, where we do a lot of stuff. The bridge to Discord is absolutely happening. That's where everything is. That's where I talk to people, talk to peers, to like-minded people. That's where the community is, and it's growing vastly. There's a lot of people there, and we welcome you with open arms and ears, mind you. Now, that means that we're doing a dance carousel, which is something that I'm going to just throw up in a second, which is just a connection of a different way to collaborate, which gets you, if you're an aspiring artist, to have your work show to the world. You can stick it on my channel through the dance carousel. I'll show you what that is at the end of this video. Now, if anything, thank you for watching. If you made it this far into the video, you, sir or ma'am, are an absolute superstar. I love you. Thank you for watching. Thank you for giving me a little bit of time a day on this little piece of the internet where you might have found me. If you're new, thanks. If you are a frequent visitor, thanks for visiting again. This concludes our broadcast day. I'm Analog Kitchen, and you'll catch me next week on another video. Peace. I'm out.
We'll be right back.